Good morning and welcome to St Mary's. It's lovely that you've joined us online for this service. If this is your first time with us, an especially warm welcome. And if you're a regular, we're delighted that you're here. Our time together will include some worship, some prayer, and some teaching from the Bible. And this morning we're continuing our series, How to Make Sense Of. Today we're looking at making sense of the dark places we all experience in life and the promises of God to help us through them. My prayer is that through it all this morning, you will discover more of God and you'll find encouragement in whatever situation you find yourself in. So shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the opportunity to gather here. We simply pray that by your Holy Spirit, you will speak to our hearts and our minds. Father, you will reveal more of who you are so that we might follow you and walk in your steps more closely. And I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Your name.
Just before the UK went into lockdown, I returned from a trip to Israel. For me, one of the highlights being a visit to a dramatic and breathtaking viewpoint overlooking a landscape of valleys or wadis, and thought to be a possible setting for Psalm 23. Now, having been there before, this time was yet more dramatic. For any who've worked in deserts will know that within minutes the weather can turn. And in this case, out of nowhere, foreboding and menacing clouds, lightning and thunder, which started echoing around the hills, intensified the experience. Psalm 23 is one of the best known passages in the Bible and is often heard read at funerals. And it famously includes the line that talks about walking through the darkest valley or deep darkness. It was penned by King David, himself a former shepherd, and it uses evocative language of God as shepherd and of host and protector. And the psalm universally rings true because all at some time in their life know what it means to be in or to experience a dark place. Now, it's understandable, isn't it, that many are experiencing dark places now. And probably less physical darkness, which is the obvious meaning in the psalm, and rather more emotional or relational or psychological darkness. The impact of COVID-19 is only likely to show itself in these areas more fully in the months and years ahead. Whatever this will be, it builds upon a picture in the UK that is already full of dark places for many people. For instance, this month, it's been reported that male suicide rates have hit a 2-decade high in England and Wales. We have a well-documented loneliness epidemic. When it hit the headlines a couple of years ago, it was reported that loneliness was thought to affect around 9 million people who refer to themselves as always or often lonely, and then thought to be a comparable indicator of premature death to cigarette smoking or obesity. It's that serious. And 2/3 of UK adults felt that they have nobody to talk to about their problems, no one to speak to about their mental health, relationships or money. And when it comes to mental health, the statistics are staggering. According to The Lancet, mental health problems are one of the main causes of overall disease burden worldwide. And in England, a recent study has estimated that every week, 1 in 6 people experience a common mental health problem. So let's look at the wisdom in the Bible that will help us make sense of our situation and will offer ways through the darkness. Psalm 23 reads, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The meaning of the psalm, I think, is quite clear. It's of a loving God, a shepherd who provides for our needs, a guide and a protector through all the challenges of life. And so what I want to do is just offer 4 simple suggestions to help us make sense of the darkness we might be experiencing, and what you can do to help yourself through. Firstly, if you're experiencing a dark place, if you're feeling discouraged, if you're feeling anxious, I'd want you to be reminded of the greatest force, the greatest power known to mankind to bring about healing to our lives. And that force is a knowledge and an experience of God's love. Those with objections to God often come asking about, saying, how can it be that God is loving when there's so much pain and suffering in the world? Now, there are some clear answers to help dispel that misunderstanding. But as you read through the Bible, time and again you see the true nature of God, his hesed love, his loving kindness, his unfailing love, his steadfast love. We see this in verse 6, where David talks of God's love following him all the days of his life, whatever might happen. You can't get away from God's love. In fact, there is a sense of God's love chasing you down. God is love. It's as simple as that. That's the definition. You find that in 1 John 4, verse 16. God's love is extraordinarily powerful. It's not an abstract idea. God's love is a tangible presence which brings healing and wholeness to a person's life. You can't feel the love of God and feel discouraged at the same time. And God showed his love most fully to us in giving his only son Jesus to die for you and me, to take away our sin so that the barrier between us and God might be removed, so that we might come to know God, the creator of heaven and earth. Not that we deserved it or earned it in any way. It is extraordinary, this God of love that we can know. But how do we receive God's love? It's poured out into our hearts through the work of the Holy Spirit. You see that in Romans chapter 5, verse 5. It says this, and hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So, if you've been born again, if you've received Jesus and know that you're a child of God, then with whatever strength you have and in whatever situation you find yourself in, just try and reach out to God and ask that you might be filled with his love and experience this love of God in your life. For me, one of the most powerful promises in the Bible is about the nature of God's love is found in 1 John chapter 4, verse 18. And it's the promise that God's love drives out fear in our life, allowing us to be at peace. And it reads this, there is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Now, if you're not a Christian, but you would like to experience this love of God, you can do so by putting your faith in Christ and acknowledging your need of him as Lord and Saviour and turning away from your sin and selfishness. Secondly, remember that no matter what you go through, God will go through it with you and alongside you. Verse 4, as said that David said, even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. You are absolutely never alone in life. You may feel alone, but God's presence is not a feeling. At every stage of your life, God will be with you. God will always be with you, no matter what you go through during this uncertain and troubling time. And whatever the days ahead hold, you're not going to go through it on your own. Promise after promise in the Bible talks about God's presence with us. Take, for example, another great example in Isaiah 43. I'm going to read from verse 2. When you pass through the waters, I, God, will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Saviour. Do not be afraid, for I am with you. It's good just to soak in these promises and to allow God's truth to shape your thinking and an understanding of who you are. Thirdly, remember this. Whatever it is that you're experiencing going through now, it's not the end of the story. Now, I've read the last chapter of the Bible and I know how it all ends. So sorry if you were hoping for a spoiler alert. In the closing verse of our Psalm, Psalm 23, we have a reference to eternity. It said this, surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You know, the tension goes down when you know the end of the story. Knowing this during this season and then the days to come is really important. In another part of the New Testament, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9, we read this. We often suffer, but we are never crushed. Even when we don't know what to do, we never give up. In times of trouble, God is with us. And when we're knocked down, we get up again. So, we get knocked down, but we get up again. We're knocked down, but we're not knocked out. Why? Because we know that God, who raised Jesus back to life, is going to raise us back to life, and he'll bring us into his presence, and he will give us hope in the middle of our pain. But what we have to do is focus on what is unchanging. You've got to change your focus. You have to shift your perspective, and you have to live in the light of eternity. Things are always changing around us. We don't know what the future holds, but we do know who holds the future, and we do know that what we're going through now is not the end of the story. One day, all our grief and pain are going to end. There is no suffering in heaven, no sickness, no sadness. There's such a beautiful passage in the Bible at the very end of the book of Revelation, chapter 21, verse 4. It's worth reading. It says this: "Then he," referring to God, "will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." What we're experiencing and going through now is not the end of the story. We can have confidence no matter whatever we're going through, because we know how the story ends. Finally, I want you to remember that God wants you to help others. Yes, God wants to comfort you. God wants to comfort me. Yes, God wants to help us through these tough times, but he also wants us to help others. In these days, perhaps unlike any other we've experienced, we're being given opportunities to love our neighbour. Let's look once more at verse 4. There's something really important to notice. It talks about walking through the darkest valley because God is with us. It said this: "Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." We need to learn to walk through darkness. Anxiety, fear, uncertainty can push us to withdraw from people even more than usual. We need to fight against that. Remember that there's more to your life than just you. It's not about you. The more self-focused you become, the more discouraged you're likely to get. Life is bigger than you. We need to take the focus of our problems, broaden our perspective to include others, and the discouragement will diminish. Acclaimed Christian author Tim Keller, in his excellent book, Walking with God Through Pain and Suffering, writes the following: "Most books and resources to sufferers today no longer talk about enduring infliction, but instead use vocabulary drawn from business and psychology to enable people to manage, reduce, and cope with stress, strain, or trauma. Sufferers are counseled to avoid negative thoughts, to buffer themselves with time off, exercise, and supportive relationships, to problem solve and to learn to accept things we can't change. But all the focus is on controlling your immediate emotional responses and environment. For centuries, however, Christianity has gone both higher and deeper in order to furnish believers with resources to face tribulation." So in Psalm 23 and elsewhere in the Bible, we see the insistence that suffering is something that must be walked through. The promise is not that God will remove us from the experience of suffering. The promise is that God will be with us, walking beside us in it. And what of walking? Walking is something non-dramatic. It's something that's rhythmic. It consists of steady, repeated actions you can keep up in a sustained way for a long time. For the Christian, a walk is day in, day out Bible reading, day in, day out praying, day in, day out obedience. It's about being deeply connected with other Christians. It's about committing yourself and being fully participant in the life and the mission of a local church. And the practice of these disciplines in the good times will help carry you through the dark times and the dark places. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity to look into your word and to see some of the promises that you speak over our lives. Father God, I pray for all that are listening to this talk. Lord God, I pray that they might have a new revelation of your love. And Lord God, as they call out to you, I pray that they may be filled with your love, that they might have the confidence to walk through whatever situation and circumstances they find themselves in. Lord God, we thank you that you're a loving God. We thank you that you care and protect and provide for us. Lord God, we love you. We pray you simply keep your hand upon us, guiding and leading us. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands. For I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands. For I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Oh, I feel like dancing. It's foolishness, I know. But when the world has seen the lights, they will dance with joy like we're dancing now. Dancing away like we're dancing now. They will dance with joy like we're dancing now. I could sing of your love forever. Sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever.
We do hope you've enjoyed your time with us this morning, and we look forward to welcoming you again. Now, if you'd like to find out more about what takes place at St Mary's, please do join us for other online services, or if you're local, come along to one of our in-person services. Why not take a moment to fill out one of our Get Connected cards? Following on from this service, we're going to be gathering on Zoom to connect and to meet with others and to reflect on our topic this morning. So once the service is finished, why don't you make yourself a coffee and then join with others online? The connection details will be displayed at the end of this service. Now, if you're interested in meeting with others in a small group and growing in your faith, Connect groups offer a great opportunity for doing this. And do get in contact with us if you're interested in joining one of those. And if you'd like to explore more about the claims of the Christian faith, Alpha is a great place to do that. If you'd like to join our next course or have any questions about it, please email alpha@stmaryspurley.org.uk. But now, I'd like to close with a blessing. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you, wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors.
You said that.